Welcome to Whores Talk Horror.
We're not really whores. We just like wordplay.
Hello, welcome to Whores Talk Horror. I'm Sharon.
I'm Melinda.
All right, so today we have a very, very exciting interview. We have Tatiana and Adriana who are going to be telling us some of their personal paranormal experiences. And welcome to the show, ladies.
Thank you.
Thank you for inviting us.
Thank you so much for coming. We're excited to have you.
And so why don't you tell us, whoever wants to start, a little bit about the background of your family, because you have a long history of having paranormal experiences in your family. So tell us a little bit about that.
It comes from, as far as I know, from my grandmother. She is a Indian by birth in South America, Colombia. So she taught us how to pray in their language, all of us grandkids, so wow. We knew. And she would do and say things when we were little, you know, how to protect us against the evil spirits and against all this stuff. And she would have us talk to our dolls and say, make sure you tell them they can't stay in there. So I grew up not knowing that that wasn't, you know, normal. and I only had one doll really when I was growing up, and my grandma was the one that got it for me, and she would dress it up and everything, but she just made sure that don't let anything get in it. And I thought it was like, you know, stick things in this side of it or something. But she protected it and so that it wouldn't be a vessel.
Wow.
So, and I didn't know that. My mom knew, but she didn't tell me. I was little.
And there's obviously a lot of horror movies that are based on that, but I didn't know that there was any sort of actual cultural, like historical significance in that. So is this something that in the Colombian culture they believe that dolls can be vessels for spirits, or?
The thing that I won't be able to say anything about is because I was brought here to the United States when I was 6. So all that was left behind.
All right.
So I didn't really come to see my grandmother until I was 10 years old. That was the last time I saw her, and she passed on. But she was very in tune with nature. She would tell you, it's going to rain tomorrow, you know. And she would be like, do you see those ants going over there? They're getting ready, you know.
Yeah.
And it was just, and she was so loving. And all the dogs and cats would follow her everywhere.
Aww.
And the birds and everything. She was just a really beautiful, beautiful being. And my mom's the same way. My mother is very, very in tune with spirituality and always uses the pentagram symbol to protect.
Mm-hmm.
The way that she explained it to me when I was little, that the pentagram is like a person standing up and doing the star. You're the head, the hands, and the legs, and that is the universe trying to protect.
Oh. Earth, air, fire, water, spirit.
Exactly. So as little, that's how what we were, you know, brought to known. And then all of a sudden I grow up and it's like pentagram.
Because it doesn't have an evil. I used to wear pentagram jewelry in high school and college, and to me it was always about the spirit, you know, earth, air, fire, water, spirit, and my connection to nature as well. It had nothing to do with the devil. That you know, I'm not sure how the pentagram became this evil symbol, because it's really a pagan symbol.
Well, probably the scares in the 80s about all the Satanism and all that kind of stuff. But I was just going to say that, like, a lot of horror movies, to your point earlier, do use dolls. And they say that, like, fiction comes from a true place somewhere. But I never heard of anyone or would have thought to do any sort of protection on a child's doll. I think that is, like, the smartest thing ever. That's awesome.
So, you know? I have a friend that is from Haiti.
Oh, okay.
And she told me about dolls and how in their culture, they used to put like evil spirits in the dolls to prevent them from harming anyone.
To trap the
soul inside the doll to prevent it from harming anyone.
Sure.
And then what would they do with the dolls then?
Burn them.
Makes sense.
Yeah, interesting.
Mm-hmm. So maybe that's where that came from? I don't know. But that's a good theory.
I'm going to have to do some research on this later, because yes. I'm sure there's many cultures that have this belief now. I just was never aware of it, but I think it's really fascinating. Yeah, very much. Adriana, this is directed towards you. Do you have a time in your life where you remember experiencing your first paranormal experience?
Funny you say. I didn't know that you know, that they didn't exist.
Other people don't see them.
Yeah, it's like, it's natural. I do remember that when my mother's great aunt passed away, I was very little, so I must have been 6 years old. And we had gone, and because I was little, they didn't let me in. Mm. They didn't let me in. I was sitting there and everything, and my great aunt came and sat next to me. Mm-hmm. And I was like, you know, I don't know what we're doing over here, you know. It was my first time, but I didn't know that she was the one that we were there to see.
Oh, my gosh.
You know, but I saw her there, but I didn't go in, so I didn't know that she was not there anymore. You know what I mean?
Gosh.
And so, and I didn't realize it until, like, I was an adult almost, because I didn't say anything to my mom or my grandmother or anything, because, you know, it's family. You know, you're sitting down and there they are, you know.
Yeah.
Hey, how you doing? You know.
And how are you able to distinguish between you seeing a spirit and then, like, a real person? Is there a difference between, you know, how they look? Are they more, like, transparent, or, you know, kind of how you would see them in the movies? Or
no, to me, when I was little, that's how I just saw them and didn't know that they were in.
So as you're looking at me or Mindy,
yeah, like
or
that.
We would
she
be
was
wow.
just there. But as I got older, like, I guess your powers are not, or not powers, but the gift is not there anymore, because you're so involved with materialistic stuff and all
right.
that stuff, you kind of lose all that. So nowadays, I do see them in the corner of my eyes and stuff, but they communicate through knocks with me.
Okay.
And stuff like that. Or in my dreams, I'll tell her, my daughter, you know, hey, you know, watch out. I dreamt this, you know.
Yeah.
This is going on and stuff like that. But as I was growing up, it was different events and different things. There really isn't one way of pinpointing, you know, this is going to happen. Missed or not missed. Or I can feel the presence.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like I was explaining, if you walk around and all of a sudden you feel this and you're feeling it in the back of your neck, you know something's there. And I'm like, okay, I don't have time for you right now. I'm busy. And that's how I dealt with it.
Okay. But I love that your aunt was like, I wanted to say hi to you, but they wouldn't let you in, so I'm going to come hang out with you.
You know, she was just like, you know, I'm sitting here with you. What you doing? You know, type of thing and all that stuff. And my brother was with me. I don't know if he saw him or not, but he was there. We were sitting out here. We're like, man, what the heck they're doing in there?
And you had a conversation with her?
Yeah. Wow. She was just there. You know.
And Tatiana, when did you first start learning about your family's history with, you know, seeing the dead, I guess?
Well, just like my mother was raised knowing and being, like, protected and all that thing, all those things by my great-grandmother, I was raised the same way by my grandmother and my mom. And so, to me, it was all those things were pretty normal and natural. I mean, ever since I was little, my mother and I would watch scary movies together. So it was pretty much a norm where, you know, my father's side of the family, the kids were not really allowed to see scary movies because they would get, you know, they would have nightmares. And my mom was like, come watch this scary movie with me. You know?
Because I would explain to her that it's not real. In that and the
right.
way it is for us, it's nothing like that. So
right.
I would laugh. You
okay.
know, I'd be the one in the movie theater sitting all the way back and watching them screaming. Ah.
That's amazing.
So when was your first paranormal experience, Tatiana?
It was when I was younger. I honestly can't really pinpoint the exact age. I want to say I was like maybe 11 or something like that. We had just moved into a house in Wisconsin because we used to live here in Chicago, and we moved into a house in Wisconsin. And just like out of the blue one day, my mom asked me to go get her glasses from the bathroom. And the way that her room was set up was that you have to go through her room to get to the bathroom. And when you go through the room, on your left-hand side was her bed, and on the right-hand side was her dresser, and there was a mirror on the dresser. And so back then, my uncle, he used to be a ghost hunter.
we'll put a pin in that. Yeah, thank you.
But the reason why I bring that up is because he had advised me that if I ever wanted to see a ghost, that to keep in mind that you see him in your peripheral vision and to try not to blink and just kind of turn and that you'll see them. And so when I was walking through my mom's bedroom to go get her glasses, and she was downstairs, I walked through and I noticed that there was something out of place on the it was on the bed, and I could see the reflection of it in the mirror at the same time. So I saw them on both sides, and I kept walking through because I was like, okay, that was not normal. As I get to the bathroom and I pick up my mom's glasses, I was like, there shouldn't have been anything on there. And so I remembered what my uncle had told me, and I decided to, like, as I was going back out to go give my mom her glasses, I stopped right where it was in between the bed and the dresser, and I decided not to blink because I could still see it in my peripheral vision, and I turned to look at my mom's bed, and I saw a little girl sitting on my mom's bed. And she was all in white. She had dark hair. It was like an old, kind of like an old-fashioned style, like, haircut.
Like a pageboy?
Yeah. Well, she had bangs, and her hair was, like, shoulder length. And she was wearing all white, and she had, like, I can't remember if, I think they were either white, I want to say they were white shoes with little black socks, or black shoes with little white socks, one of those two. And, but when I looked at her, she was like, it almost looked like she was holding on to a bear or a stuffed animal or something. Mm-hmm. And it was a stuffed animal that my mom would always have on her bed.
Oh.
And but her eyes, when I looked it through her eyes, it was like very hollow. Like there was nothing there. Like there was no spirit. Like, you know, like when you look at somebody, they're alive. But, yeah. When you see somebody that's passing away or something, you know, it's like they fade away, you know, and there was like nothing there. Like her eyes were almost transparent. Like,
wow.
And it was really creepy. And then all of a sudden I hear my mom go, Tatiana, we gotta go.
And then poof, she was gone.
And then, no, I turned around to just run out, and I didn't bother to look back or anything. I just remember like kind of being in shock at like, what is this girl doing here? Like, I was like, okay. And then my mom was like, Tatiana. And so I went down. And then ever since then, like, I kept seeing her in the house.
Wow.
And it was for years. For years I kept seeing her. And it would be like I would be changing, or my dresser in my bedroom would be facing the door, which was like in a corner.
Okay.
And so I'd be getting ready, and I would see her in the reflection of the mirror behind me. And she'd just be standing there just watching me, you know. Or I'd just be, you know, walking down the hall, and she'd be by my mom's door. It was always between, like, my room and my mom's room. And the thing is that my room was right next to my mom's room.
Okay.
One day, like, not when I was, like, 14, my parents had thrown me, like, a birthday party and got me this huge balloon. And I mean, like, one of those big, like, inflatable, like, balloons, like, the big ones, you know. I would always have it away from my bed. And my bed, because I was young, I had like a canopy, the round ones that go over the bed. And I would sleep in it. So in order for you to get in it, you have to like kind of like duck down and move the canopy to get in it, right? So I went to sleep that night, one night, and I had a crazy dream that I woke up because I heard the tea kettle going in the kitchen downstairs. And I wake up in my dream, and I go downstairs to turn it off. And it was daylight in my dream.
Mm-hmm.
And I go downstairs to turn it off, and all of a sudden I turn around to go back upstairs, and this woman was there. And she was, like, maybe in her teens or something. And she looked at me. She's like, what are you doing here? But it was the same little girl, just grown up.
Wow.
Yeah. And she's like, what are you doing here? I'm like, what do you mean? I just came to turn. You're not supposed to be here. You have to go. You can't be here. You gotta go. And I'm like, what? And I didn't know where to go. I'm like, what do you mean? It's my house. Where am I gonna go?
Yeah.
You know? And so I just ran upstairs to my room and I closed the door and I like went under my covers in my dream. And, you know, wow. I still had the canopy and everything. So it seemed very real, you know, and I'm under there and I had the covers under me. And all of a sudden, like in my dream, the balloon was still in there. Wow. I'm looking in the corner where the door is and the balloon is there and I see it floating, getting closer and closer to me. And the canopy was slightly open.
Oh my gosh.
And it went down in under the canopy and it was floating above me. And I'm just looking at it, just watching it do its thing.
Oh, right?
And I'm like, what is it doing? And as it gets closer, it starts getting closer and it comes down and it comes right to my face and it's right at my face and it transforms into the girl's face, the little girl's face. And she goes, boo. And she woke me up from my dream. It was so scary. Like, it scared me so much in my dream that it woke me up. And all of a sudden, all I hear her is laughing and my balloon floating inside my canopy.
Oh my gosh.
Which was not there before.
No.
Oh my god.
No, because it was out by the door.
And
it was like it happened in real life. You know, it was like a weird like thing.
So, do you think that was this someone that lived in the house prior or do you know who this person was? Or
okay, well, I can come into that one.
Okay.
we had that house built.
Oh, okay.
So it was completely nothing. And well, she told me about her dream. And so what happened was that I know exactly who she was.
Oh.
In 1990, your sister 92, 1990, I had a pregnancy. And that pregnancy had to be terminated because they told me that the fetus had died inside of me. And so it was really, really hard for me to accept that, you know, that death because it was my second child. It's 7 years between the two.
Oh,
so, I always had this. Well, before every time I'm pregnant, I know what I'm going to have because it comes in my dream. I found her in a garbage can, in an alley, and I knew it was a girl. And then,
well, I don't know what that means.
This I said, oh, I'm having a beautiful little girl out of the garbage can in my dream, right? So with this one, I saw it also, and it was one that walked to me and held on to me and was on my leg, like hanging on to me. It was a little girl with black hair and little bangs and stuff, and she was hanging on, so I knew it was going to be a girl. When that happened, I went through a lot of depression because I had that and everything. But I had it done in August. I had to do a DNC in December when it was my birthday. I got pregnant again, and the doctor told me not to have not to get pregnant because I had gone through so much trauma, but it happened. So that baby was supposed to be born April 14th. Still remember this. April 14th. So by myself, I bought a little stuffed animal, and that was her to me all these years. And personally, I would celebrate her birthday.
And that was the one you kept in your bed?
That's the one I kept in bed. I still have it, I have it put away. But it's a little bunny, and she's really cute and everything. And so I had it on my bed, and I knew that it happened, and I knew something was going to happen because the whole family was so excited to have our first home, and it was exactly how I wanted it. And I wanted it my kids, and my youngest daughter was 3 years old, so that baby would have been 5 years old.
Okay.
So that baby would have been 5 years old. And so I was so happy, but I was so upset and depressed that I couldn't give this baby this beautiful, a brand new house, brand new everything and all this stuff. So I was kind of happy, sad at the same time. I always kept it with me. Well, after we moved in, it was a two-story home. So I was doing laundry at night and in the basement, first floor, second floor. So the basement, I was doing the laundry and I was in the first floor folding clothes and I hear this laughter. Hee 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 hee. I'm like, so I thought it was my youngest one
you know, coming down because she was so excited. She was doing the stairs. She never done the stairs. She'd go up and down, up and down, up and down. Turn the lights upstairs, turn the lights downstairs. So I thought it was her. So I went up the stairs and she was sleeping. And I went in my room and I asked my husband, hey, did you hear anything? He's like, no. When I went down, as I was going down, I could hear it coming from the basement. I went in the basement. I could hear it clearly. I'm like, what the heck is that? So I went downstairs and it did it again. And it was, I saw it, and we had boxes because we were just moving in. Sure. And I saw this little doll. I don't know if you guys remember. It was a doll inside a walker, and then with a remote control, they would walk. Well, that was it. Yeah. Going for there, hitting the wall, coming back, hitting the wall, hitting the back. I'm like, what the heck? You know, somebody left the battery on. What the heck? So I opened up, and I found it. I went through boxes to find the control, and I took out that, and it still did it.
Wow.
So I had to take the thing apart. So I took the doll out of the walker and all this stuff, but inside I knew who it was. She wanted to enjoy this too.
Wow.
She wanted to enjoy this too, and then I started seeing her too. I started seeing her on my bed and everything, and I
did you tell your husband?
No. He's a chicken. We would have had to move.
Well, she liked the doll, apparently.
She loved the doll. That's awesome. She loved the doll. I don't know why. Well, maybe because she could control it, remote control it. So when she told me about it, I said, well, I think maybe we're going to have to let her go, because she didn't tell me about it and I didn't say anything. It happened for years. Mm-hmm. It came and gone. It came and gone. She would be here, and all of a sudden I see her in the kitchen on the side, and I would just talk to her in my mind. I would talk to her and say, you know, I'm so glad you're here to be with us. And all this, I would say that.
Yeah.
So I was welcoming her. Mm-hmm. So, but then she was doing that. And what I taught my kids was that if you ever feel afraid in someone, you feel someone, say boo. Mm-hmm. You scare them first.
Yeah. Oh my
God. So when she did that in her dream, I knew it was her.
That's amazing.
I knew it was her.
So the little girl you were seeing was the one who was afraid.
Yeah, she was probably afraid.
But the thing is that I would always feel that going up the stairs, because I would always feel an entity behind me going up the stairs. So I would always turn around and go, boom.
Okay.
So but you know what? I never put the two together.
I always taught my kids, always, because I know that there's so many things we don't know where we're going and what. So you scare them first. And that's, I say that to you guys too. Scare them first and they'll leave you alone.
That is okay. I've never heard that. That's fantastic. I love it.
And so anyways, and I told my daughter, I said, you know what? We're going to have to, you know, I told her, it's your sister. I told her, it's your sister, and she's here, and we need to let her go. I need to let her go, because I've had her since before she was born. And so I love babies, and, you know. Anyway, so I had to let her go, and I had to tell her to leave. I said, I know you want to be here, but you have an opportunity to come back maybe in another life and all this stuff, and I'll be here with you, and I'll always be your mother and all this stuff. So I had to let her go. But I still have my doll. My doll is still at the house. I have it.
I thought you burned it.
No.
And it sounds like there wasn't anything like negative. Like, no. She like
no, no, no.
Trouble.
She was just a little girl.
Oh,
she was growing with my youngest daughter. She was growing with her. And I don't know if my little one's seen her. I don't know, because she's also, you know, it's normal.
Right. It runs in the family.
It's a normal
Except,
thing.
It sounds like not on your husband's
side. Oh, no. They're scared of everything.
Your dad never experienced any of this stuff, never saw things or...
Well, he has, but he doesn't like to talk about it.
No.
Okay.
He's terrified.
Okay. He's more of like, we don't talk about those things.
Yeah. Okay. Sees them, but doesn't talk about it. Just pretends...
I'll never be able to sleep again. It's this thing,
Just ignore it.
Gotcha.
Okay.
Gotcha.
Before we started recording, we were talking a little bit about shadow figures.
Mm.
And you told me something that I did not know. Do you want to explain what exactly a shadow figure is?
Well, from what I was told, and I could, please, if I'm mistaken, please correct me. But I was told that shadow figures are different than spirits. They're from a different realm. They're a different entity. I seriously believe that spirits are a form of, like, you know, us passing, right? And we want to communicate, and we want to be able to be there to, like, you know, not necessarily cause any harm, but I feel that shadow people are, they're kind of like deviant, or I guess you could say, in a way. Is that the right word I want to say? Like,
I've never really done the research. I just, in one of my past episodes, I talked about when I was little and I saw a shadow figure in my room and I never really knew what it was. So, this is another thing I'm going to have to research besides the doll thing. But so were they ever living people, or are they more just kind of like a bunch of like negative energy that is kind
of, I think it's more like negative energy together.
Mm-hmm. What happens is, and this is my belief and everything from what I've seen, a lot of those entities of become demons because they want to control and they want to be in this in this world, the physical world, and they're trying to see the weak people and trying to get into them, or children and stuff like that. And that's why a soul is trying to keep with the living, their loved ones. They want to attach to the loved ones and not going to hurt them or nothing, but they're there because they don't know where to go, and then they're used to it and they didn't know they're dead.
Right.
You know, that kind of stuff. If you don't teach some people when they're going to die, you have to let go once you stop being in this world. Right. But those shadow people, they're just trying to see, because they envy us being here.
So they wish they were a soul.
Exactly.
Okay.
Inside us.
I absolutely agree with that, because I had an experience with a shadow person, actually numerous times, but the one in particular that really sticks out is my friend Carla. She's a medium. She helps communicate with the spirits and helps them cross over. She had asked me if I wanted to move in with her. And she lives in this house with like a bunch of people, like seven of us. And I said, yeah, you know, that'd be great. I wanted to move out of my house. And I was like, yes. So I moved in, and within like the first week or two, I came home and it was late. And where her room was, there was a big like street light that would shine through the window, like in front of her room, right? There was like a space in front of her door that the window would be lit all the time because of the light outside. And I came home and I saw this person standing outside of her door. Mm-hmm. And
I know, right?
And I was like I couldn't see who it is, because if the sun, you know, if the sun is shining behind you, you become like a silhouette. It looked like a silhouette of somebody.
Okay.
And I went, like, kind of walking towards them, and I was like, hey, you know, are you waiting for Carla? Are you looking for her? You know, whatever. And all of a sudden, like, this person was, like, facing the door, and this person turned around and faced me and just started chasing me, like, started just running towards me. And I was like, ah! And I started running. And I was freaking out. And I just started running towards my room, and I go into my room, and I've always, my grandmother, my mother have always told me to protect my room, you know, do like sage, all sorts of different things so that nothing comes into my room. So I run into my room and I close the door, and all of a sudden it was like banging on the door, like boom boom boom, like just banging, trying to get in to my room. And I was screaming, I was like, God.
Did they have a face when they turned around?
It was, it was so dark. The person had a hat on. And it was so dark. And it was like an old figure, you know, like antique kind of.
That's what my shadow figure was. It was like a wide brim hat, and they also had like a long coat.
Yeah.
Yeah, and there's just like, I'm so glad I only saw this once when I was a kid, and I'm so glad that I wanted to scream for my parents, but I was so scared that like if I screamed, it would have come at me. So I just pulled,
and it probably would have.
Oh my God, I'm so glad.
And it's funny because my friends from California, I have friends from California, and I told them about this story, and apparently they're very well-known in California.
Just gonna say, if you look online, there's like all sorts of blogs about what's with the guy with the hat, like it's
insane. And there's also shadow people that are dressed in cloaks. So I've seen those too, and my friends in California, they told me that those are demons, because when I would see those, they would have like red eyes or something great, like a different color eyes, like beaming, you know. And I'm not just saying this from myself, but I was with my friend Tina and Alicia, and we were walking in the forest one time in Wisconsin, and the three of us saw the exact same figure, and it was a shadow person in a cloak, like with their hands like this, like on top of each other, you know, yeah. like a cloak thing, like a cult, yeah, almost, yeah, yeah. you know, and we were like, what the hell is that? Who is that? And yeah. we would get closer, and then all of a sudden, like, these beaming red lights are on us, like, eyes, and we just start running. And the more we ran, we would see, like, more, like, on the side of a peripheral vision, and we were just like, screw this.
It was like a trap.
That's how the cults get people.
Well, and I'm kids. I'm no expert by any stretch. I've just always been interested in the subject and would, like, read about it, again, since I was a kid. My mom showed me my first scary movie, actually. but while you were talking about the shadow figure in your house and the banging on the door, I don't know if you saw, but your mom held up her hand and said that
they knocked three times,
which mm-hmm. I've heard is supposed to be like mocking the Trinity. Is that true?
I don't know about that, but if you open the door, you let them in. Yeah. If they knock three times. And I have a great story about that.
Ooh, but please share. I was going to share.
Well, I live in San Antonio now, and we have our new house. It's brand new. So we built it and everything. And my husband and I, we were there about three, four days, and we were really good. And all of a sudden, I hear knocking on the door, 1, 2, 3. And I'm like, So I look through the, it's a glass door, so you could see. And I'm like, there's nothing there. And I told my husband, don't open the door. Mm. Do not open the door. You know, because a lot of people, when they're envy of you, and we had just got this, they accidentally, without knowing, send that vibe to you. Send it, and it becomes something. And you have to be very careful, and I keep telling her and my daughter, if people are envy and they have something that's not right about them, it's something that follows them,
okay.
they send it out.
That kind of makes sense.
So I heard the three knocking. I said, don't. So we went in my room, in our room with the door closed, and guess what? They came knocking in my door in my room. My husband to this day won't open the door unless I open it. He's that scared. I said,
he makes you open
and
it.
I said, look, you're not welcome here. I didn't invite you. You need to leave now.
That's good.
And that's it.
And you sound very strong. Because I've heard that you have to be like
you have to
strong.
Be very. I'm not scared because they're dead. Well, they're not here. But they feed off of your fear.
Right. Mm-hmm.
They feed off of your fear. Right. And my little dogs were barking, 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 barking outside the door. They were barking. So whatever it was, I didn't have to, and it's my fault. I was so busy doing it, I hadn't saged yet.
Oh.
You have to do that. Once it's empty and after it's not, because whatever you bring in stuff, you always have to clean. You always have to do that. Because people don't do it to be mean, but it's... It just happens. Stuff like that happens, you know.
Right.
They send that. But my husband, to this day, won't open the damn door.
I love that he makes you do it.
He's like, I've never heard of this, and this is really, really bizarre. I have another husband, not her dad.
Okay.
So it's a different one. So that one really scared him. And I was like, yep, three times. And you'll hear it, boom, boom, boom. And very, very distinct.
And really quick, you both are very, very brave ladies. Because, like, if I walked into a house and saw someone standing at the top of the stairs in a shadow, and they weren't supposed to be there, I would not have walked towards them.
Well, see, and that's the thing. Like, well, our house where I used to live with my roommate, Carla, it was a community home. So we always had people coming in and out. And okay, it was just like open to anybody. So I didn't think anything of it.
Yeah, that's a good point.
But the thing is that after I called her, she came by and she's like, are you okay? What's wrong? And I told her, I said, there was something there. And she was like, I'm sorry. That was my fault. I should have told you that I basically, like, she's an open, like, open for business, basically, yeah. You know, like, yeah, to just, you know, and she's like, when I'm done helping people, I tell them that they have to wait outside my room.
Oh, my God.
Wow.
Did she know who this person was?
No, I don't think so. But, I mean, it was a shadow person, so I don't know. Yeah. I don't know if she works with shadow people or not. I have no idea. I've never asked her. I don't want to know.
And the thing is this, too, that you have to understand, when it comes to a medium,
invites people. Mm-hmm. I mean, not people, but souls. Mm-hmm. They're actually souls. They invite souls. The souls get scared if they see someone and they can actually, that person sees them because they're like, what? So they're going to go and see, can you help me?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
So
maybe they're looking for help from
her. Help from her. Or, and she's like, oh.
And that's right, another thing, too, is that, like, I was always told by my mom and my grandmother, like, well, mainly my mom, is that the moment you acknowledge them and they know that you acknowledge them, that's it. You become this open radar, you know, because one spirit sees you and they know that you see them, then the other spirits are like, why are you following that person? Oh, that person can see you? Oh, then all these other spirits are around you and everything. So for me, if I see something, I ignore it because I don't want to be that vessel. Yeah. I don't want to have all these spirits around me because it makes me unease.
Also, yeah. You're not working customer service for ghosts who need help.
No, no. Yes, I can see you, but I don't want to deal with that. And actually, it was funny. We were just talking about it this morning with my grandmother because my grandmother was saying that she doesn't like to work in silence. Like, she doesn't like the house to be silent. So she likes to have the TV on or the radio on or something. We're all like that. Mm-hmm. I'm like that. Even being here, like mm-hmm. in any place, if it's too quiet, it freaks me out. And and my conclusion is we're so sensitive to we have that ability to hear, to see, you know, these spirits, that if it's too quiet, our natural senses is to hear, okay, where is that sound coming from? Right? So if we have a TV on or the radio on, we know it's that. Okay. If all of a sudden we hear somebody talking and it's quiet, your radar opens up and you're like, what is that? And then they're like, oh, you heard me. Exactly. You heard me. Or you saw me, you know, like if you stop, like I did when I saw my first ghost, you know, the little girl on the bed, and I stopped and I saw her. She's like, now I would see her almost all the time.
You acknowledge her. Mm-hmm. Oh my God.
So that's why I cannot work in silence. Mm-hmm. I cannot be anywhere inside. The only time I really do it is when I'm meditating. Mm-hmm. But when I'm meditating, you're in a different zone. Right. You're in a different realm. You're focusing on yourself. You're not trying to pay attention to anything else around you. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Right? So that's the difference between being in silence and meditation and being in silence on a regular daily basis.
I agree.
Hey, I forgot to tell you guys. I used to live in Northbrook, and that's where I grew up. And we went to live in this house, the house that my parents first bought us. And the owner of the house had built it.
Okay.
He built it. Well, when we moved there, like 6 months later, he passed away. And the room that I had was his, a den, where he had all his stuff on there and everything. And I had this lamp. And the lamp was an antique, and you had to turn it like this.
Right, yeah.
So, I think it was like at 3 o'clock in the morning, that lamp would turn on.
Like a hurricane lamp.
You have to turn the knob.
Like a key almost.
Knob. Yeah. And at 6 o'clock in the morning, they wake me up every single day. Every single day. And I'm like, what the heck? And they were boom, boom, boom. Wake me up in the morning every day, Saturday, Sunday. I'm like, oh, it's okay for the school day, but not on weekends, you know. And come to find out from our farm door neighbor that he had passed away, and he came back. He came back to the first place that he was at, and he was mischief in our house.
Really?
Yeah, the door cabinets would open up, and the cans would roll off. The refrigerator door, I don't know how they did that one. The refrigerator door would open up. We'd come out in the morning, the refrigerator door was wide open. We're like, what the heck? So my mom and another friend, they had to really do an intensive cleaning. And we were just, you need to go. Thank you so much for allowing us to stay in this house and everything like that. But for years, he kept waking me up at that time at 6 o'clock in the morning. Me in high school.
Did he die in the house?
No, he died in Florida.
I wonder if there was something about the time, like maybe he died at like 6 o'clock or something like that. Or?
No, I think he just wanted me up and gone from
and it was
school.
Really?
It was just like a school thing. It was just like I knew I had to go. Oh, and then
was he a teacher or something? Was there
no?
Something
he was else? He was an architect.
Okay,
but he was a real strict guy. Real strict.
He built the house?
He built the house.
Maybe he loved it.
He built the house.
He didn't want anyone else living in the house.
He welcomed. He was welcoming because he didn't scare us. He was just still living there.
You just want to say hi and get up and go to school.
Get up and go to school. And then if I was going to be late. And let me tell you, so I had to, on the corner of my house, was the bus would come, right? And I have naturally curly hair, as you guys can see. But in high school, straight was in, you know, Farrah Fawcett look, you know, with the thing like that. And I would spend an hour just doing that. And then when it was time that the bus was going to come, my blow dryer would stop working.
Oh my God.
It would always stop working. I'm like, bless it, you know? You know? And it was always at the same time. I mean, he was there. He was just on my butt all the time, every day, on my butt. And that's, I knew it was him. I knew it was him.
It's kind of sweet in a way. Oh, yeah. Like,
he didn't hurt me or nothing. And I knew who he was. I knew it was him. I could sense it. I just knew it. And I'm like, come on, let me sleep. And I go like this, and the light would turn on. I'm like, oh my God.
Did he have kids? Maybe he.
Yeah, he had a kid. He had a girl.
Darn.
A girl.
Oh, I was gonna say maybe he took on something like, you know, he never had kids, so he kind of thought of you. You know,
nobody had a daughter. So maybe she was like always on the mirror.
maybe he was like kind of hard on his daughter in real life very too, hard. And so he kind
and
of.
And we knew this because of Mary and Tom. They became their grandma and grandpa too because they were always there. It was so sweet. The neighbors, and they were there also. That same man built their house.
Oh, wow.
So they knew everything about him, and they knew, you know, he was over there at the door making sure she got on the bus every morning before he went off to work. And I'm like, well, yeah, you're still doing that with me.
Oh, wow. That is kind of sweet.
Yeah, so that was a good, you know, a good. I pretty much have had always good things, I think, because I don't let the bad ones come in. Like, I tell them, leave. Leave. You need to go. You're not allowed here. That's how I tell everybody to be that way. You know, because it's just like a little kid. Mm-hmm. They don't know what's right, what's wrong, or anything. You know, don't touch that. If they touch it, they're going to burn themselves. So don't touch it. They stop.
So Tatiana said that you have a story about a Ouija board.
Ugh. Yes, I do. Wait.
Famous Ouija board. Okay, so I had two incidents with Ouija boards. The first one, our first communion, my brother and I got, did our first communion, and I don't know who the heck gave us a Ouija board for the first communion. Even my mom was like, what? You know, who does that, you know, especially Catholics. So anyways, my brother and I didn't know. We were little.
Sure. That was made by Parker Brothers. Like,
yeah, it was like it was there in Toys R Us, you know, in the aisle of all the game room stuff. So we were starting to play around and stuff with it and all that. And then it would just kind of do this, you know. Oh, and whatever we put, it would just move. It would move. And we're like, my brother's like, you're doing that. And I go, I'm not doing shit.
Yeah.
You know, so my mom walked in and she says, no, we gotta burn that thing. And we went outside and she's tried to burn it and the thing would not burn.
I've heard that's the worst thing to do with Ouija boards
is burn them
because it releases whatever's in there.
I don't know. You're also not supposed to throw them away. I don't know what you're supposed to do.
Don't buy them.
Yeah.
So when I was in high school, then I don't know what happened to it, to tell you the truth. Maybe my mom just threw it away in the garbage and someone else got that look. But the second one was in high school. I went to Glenbrook North. One of our friends, his name was Charlie Brown.
Aww.
And Charlie Brown got into a big accident. He climbed one of the transformers and the thing blew up. Oh, and when it blew up, Charlie Brown went down. And then John, my friend, went running to get help, and there was a train, and he didn't even notice because the train just grabbed him.
Oh my gosh.
I took him off. Well, I was devastated. I was a freshman, sophomore year old, something like that. So anyways, I was devastated. I went through a lot of hardship. It's like, I knew that he was dead, and I knew that, and I'm like, where is he gonna go now? Right. We had so many dreams and hopes. Like, the first person I actually knew and, you know, was with that is no longer with me.
Yeah, and so, your age.
And my age.
Oh my gosh.
So I went, and they didn't even have an open casket or anything, and because they couldn't find all of them. Mm-hmm. And so the brother was there, and I could see the brother, and the brother was like, he was in the military. He came in, and he was devastated. 2 days later, he blew his head off. So this was all like right there, and I was like, what the heck? heck? You know, it was like, oh, so much stuff. And this lady came to visit my mom. And she came from Colombia. And she had a Ouija board. And she told me, you know, my mom had told her about it. And she, without my mom knowing it, did the Ouija board with me.
Oh.
And I was like so eager to find out where that I wish I wouldn't have done it, to tell you the truth, because it even made my senses more. And we did it. And he told me, my name is Adriana, okay? And he called me Audie. And on there, it came Audie.
Wow.
On that. So I was like freaking out. And then I asked him, well, where are you? And he said it was really cold and it was really dark. And I said, what? And he told me, you have to obey the 13 commandments.
I'm sorry, what?
Exactly. Did you guys look it up?
13.
There's 13. 13 commandments.
See, he's not referring to the 10 commandments from the Bible.
It's 13 commandments. He told me that. I had to look it up.
I wrote it down. We'll look it up.
There's 13 commandments.
Write down dolls. What was the other thing you were going to talk about?
I won't forget that.
Dolls and shadow figures.
So he told me that he was stuck.
Oh my gosh.
He was stuck.
It's like a purgatory.
He was stuck. He didn't see the light. He didn't know anything. He was stuck. He was stuck there. And I'm like, so now what? You know, what do you do? And then, and that's when I started, like, I'm not going to find out this stuff, because what do I do? How do I let him go? How do I help? How do I help him? And he followed me for a while.
Wow.
He followed me for a while until I told him, look, you need to go. You need to. And I was like, what, 13, 14 years old? What am I supposed to do? I was in high school. You know, I was like a freshman. I was 14, 13 years old. And, but he followed me, and he followed me to the school, because my book would, where we used to draw each other, my book would fly out of my hand and go down on the floor. So he was there, and I'm like, look, you need to go. You need to go. You need to go. And I think he did go, because then I stopped feeling him around me. But because of the Ouija board, I found out that if you don't know you're dead, you're stuck. Like, he went to save him.
Because he was so focused on my friend.
Yeah, he went to save him, and he didn't know.
That's so true.
And he was my age. I mean, anyone that age, are they prepared?
No.
I'm prepared.
That's sad.
I know, because I've died.
What?
Okay.
Gotta elaborate.
I've died too.
And on that note...
All right, so I think this is a good place to end the conversation. Join us next week when we hear how Tatiana and Adriana have both died. And a lot of other stories. So this is definitely going to be a multi-part interview. And as always,
thanks for getting creepy with us.
Goodbye.
Bye.